sing your hallelujah for all I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross, where mercy paid for me. Where the wrath I deserve, it is gone, it is past. Your blood has hidden me. Mercy.
Good morning, Church of Philippi families. It's so good to be able to worship with you today once again on this Sunday morning. And as we prepare to go into a time of singing and going in time of the Word, if we could first start by taking a moment to ask the Lord to really open the eyes of our hearts, and that we would be able to hear His voice this morning, and that we would have humble hearts to worship Him and honor Him. So let's take a moment now to prepare our hearts for this time of worship.
이 시간 우리 겸손한 마음으로 하나님 앞에 나아가길 원합니다. 우리 함께 하시는 주님을 기억함으로 이 시간 우리 예배에 앞서서 우리 함께 모인 그곳에서 하나님께 기도하는 마음으로 이 예배를 사모하는 마음으로 준비하며 나가도록 하겠습니다.
Obey and so often turn our backs to you. So this morning, would we remember your great love and worship and honor you for how truly amazing you are. Right now I pray that for each family who is watching this service, that you would speak into their hearts, the parents, the children. Maybe some are feeling discouraged, frustrated, or alone. God, would you cover them with your mighty love, with your great hand over them, and remind them of how cared for and loved that they are by you, our Heavenly Father.
하나님 아버지 감사합니다. 우리에게 예수 그리스도를 통하여 하나님의 크신 사랑을 보여주신 것을 감사드립니다. 이 시간 우리의 마음 가운데 말씀하여 주시옵소서. 주님 앞에 예배하는 우리 부모님들 또 아이들의 마음 속에 하나님 주님의 사랑을, 주님의 그 크신 사랑을, 주님의 인자하심을, 주님의 그 놀라우심을 말씀하여 주시옵소서. 바라볼 때 주님 우리 안에 주님께서 주시는 힘과 용기와 능력과 지혜가 넘쳐날 것을 믿습니다. 예배를 통해 하나님 영광 받으시고 주님 바라볼 때 하나님께 예배하는 모든 가정 위에 하나님의 축복을 더하여 주시옵소서. 모든 영광 주님께 올려드리며 살아계신 우리 주 예수 그리스도의 이름으로 기도드립니다.
We're going to now move into a time of singing worship. So if you would like, you can follow along with the lyrics on the screen as we declare truths about our Lord. So He became sin.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing. Your love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name above all names. Blessed Redeemer.
Jesus. Jesus Messiah, the Lord of
worship service together. We're going to now move into a time of offering. So if you'd like to give online, you can follow the prompts, which will be on your screen now.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. It's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
we once again thank you that you are a God who knows us. You hold all things in your hands, and you are working all things for good. And so this morning, as we are gathered as families, Lord, would you once again remind us of truths of who you are, of your faithfulness, of your grace, and your mercy over our lives. Would you remind us of who we are, living in your kingdom as your children in whom you dwell. God, would you remind us of that and give us a confidence and a courage and a hope that is found in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask for that. We ask for deep reminders of your love, for hope this morning over such difficult times, God. It has felt so long and so challenging. We ask that you would fall afresh upon us, that we would find hope to face the day, and that we would declare worship to you, and that your glory would be further revealed in our lives, and that we would be led to shine your light and your glory in the lives around us, God. So would you meet us in this time as we open your word, as we declare more and hear more truths of your character and your love for us, God. We pray this all in Jesus' precious name. Before we go into a time in the Word, we are going to now have or hear some announcements from the church, from Kim Kyun Hoksanim. So if you could hold tight as we hear and are informed more of what's going on in our church family.
네, 오늘 처음 예배 가운데 나오신 한 분 한 분 주님의 이름으로 환영합니다. 특별히 새가족 등록을 홈페이지를 통해서 하실 수 있습니다. 그리고 또 계속해서 우리가 온 오프라인으로 예배를 드리고 있는데 이 본당에서 함께 1부와 2부 예배 드리시기 원하시는 분들은 이 주보에 나온 스케줄에 따라서 이 홈페이지에서 신청서를 작성해 주시면 선착순에 의해서 함께 이곳에서 예배 드리실 수 있음을 알려드립니다. 첫 번째 교회 소식 알려드립니다. 생명의 삶 8호로가 입고되었습니다. 생명의 삶 필요하신 분들은 교회 정문에 비치되어 있으니 오셔서 구입하셔서 가지고 가실 수 있습니다. 두 번째 선교 기도 모임 안내입니다. 선교 기도 모임이 다음 주일 오전 10시에 있습니다. 특별히 우리 파송 선교사인 우리 임지영 선교사님 그리고 최연희 선교사님과 함께 만나서 기도할 예정입니다. 참여를 원하시는 분들은 권기환 우리 선교부장님께 연락 주시기 바랍니다. 다음은 YMCM 소그룹 그리고 어와나 한국학교 등록 안내입니다. YM과 CM 사랑방과 소그룹 등록을 오늘부터 받습니다. 한 가지 아셔야 할 것은 등록한 학생들만 소그룹과 사랑방에 편성될 수가 있습니다. 그래서 부모님들께서 꼭 자녀들에게 알려주시고 또 부모님들께서 등록하여 주셔서 이 기간 내에 모든 것들이 잘 완료되어 질 수 있도록 협조를 부탁드립니다. 마찬가지로 어와나와 한국학교도 홈페이지를 통해서 또 주보에 나와 있는 링크를 통해서 등록하실 수 있습니다. 참고해 주시기 바랍니다. 네, 오늘 CM 온라인 소그룹 모임이 있습니다. 나이대로 맞춰서 두 그룹으로 나뉘어져서 소그룹 모임을 갖습니다. 함께 참여하셔서 귀한 은혜 나누는 시간 되기를 원합니다. 이어서 스테이시 전사님 말씀, 하나님의 말씀 전해 듣도록 하겠습니다.
Good morning, Church of Philippi. 안녕하세요, 우리 빌립보 가정 여러분. 오늘 말씀은 우리 가족에 대한 띔이 아주 큽니다. 그래서 가족들 같이 앉아 계시면 같이 좀 더 가까이 앉으시고 그리고 똑바로 앉으라고 혼내지 마시고 Children, youth, KYM youth, everyone, can you please sit up a little bit so your mom and dad don't have to tell you that again? I've been hearing many times that your moms and dads are wanting you to worship and meet God, but a lot of times you're rolling around and they feel upset. So let's sit up straight and get ready for God's word today. So as we start today, I'd like to show you a very special picture of my family, not just my little family, but my extended family, my siblings and my mother and father and my siblings' spouses and their firstborn children. There's a really epic picture I want to show you. Can you please show us the picture? Isn't it so amazing? I love this picture. It's one of our family's favorite pictures ever. It was so hard for all of us to get into the hanbok, and especially to put the little ones in the hanbok, and my little one didn't even have a hanbok. But, and it was such a hot day. I was sweating so much like I'm doing these days in August. But look how beautiful the picture turned out. And it's one of our family treasures. that we will treasure forever, this very beautiful picture of all the generations of my side of the family, my father and mother, me, my sister and brother and their siblings, I mean their spouses and their children. It's a three-generation picture. And I wanted to ask you, when was the last time your family took that kind of big, kind of generational picture? And if you have taken that, I want to ask you, do you know why families do this? It's not just to look pretty, but it's actually to see in one view, like a panorama of who are my family members? Who are the generations in our family? Who is going to continue on our family line? It's a beautiful thing. Do your parents have any photo albums of when they were little? If you do, do you look at them regularly? Is this a thing that your family does? We do at my family, and you really should try it. Just look through the photo albums, and if you see an interesting picture, just ask your parents, tell me the story behind this picture. As you look at the pictures and people, it reminds us, oh, I'm not just someone who was born one day randomly, but these pictures remind us of all the people that came before me. And even though my parents' childhood was a long time ago and it was very different from me, you can remember they grew up in a certain way. They have stories that formed who they are, and how they grew up actually determines how you live your everyday life right now. That's the ideas they bring into your family. That's how they parent you. So it's really important to understand who they are, where they came from, and what their stories were. Now, going back a little bit further, I want to ask if you know about your family tree. So beyond your mom and dad, beyond maybe your grandma and grandpa, but a little bit more further up, how far back can you draw your family tree? Maybe after worship today, you can ask your parents about it. Because in the Bible times, the family tree was very, very important, more important than nowadays even. And for the people of Israel, you know, last month we've been looking at how the people returned to the promised land of Israel after their years of captivity. And Ezra especially had commanded, he said, everyone here needs to prove what tribe they're from, what family they're from, what is their family tree and family line, so that they could receive again their promised land for their family. It was really important as they restarted life as God's people. This family line was what they used to make sure that they were included as part of God's family. They were even told, don't marry anyone that's outside of this family. We have to keep this family pure. And so they tried their best to keep the family tree pure, just of people of Israel and Judah as much as possible, because that was very important to them. And there's a really special word I want to teach you today, especially for the younger friends here. They might not know this word. It's the word genealogy. That's just a fancy word for family tree. So what do you know about the genealogy of Jesus? That's what today's message is. It's from Adam to Christ. We're going to spend this month looking into the story of Jesus and his birth and his family tree. And today's message is that first one, from Adam to Christ. And it's going to help us answer a very important big picture question. CM children are familiar with this, but every new unit we begin, there is a big picture question that kind of shows us the big story of what is God all about. So this month's big picture question is Jesus God or a human? What is he? Who was he exactly? Is Jesus God or a human? So we're going to find the answer to that this month. Now, we all know that Jesus was definitely human. We have four whole books in the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that record all about his earthly life on earth. And nobody can deny that he was a real human being. He had a real human body that felt pain and hunger, and Jesus needed to sleep just like you and me. Jesus had feelings just like you and me. He sometimes felt happy or sad or angry or concerned. And Jesus also felt tempted to sin, just like you and me. But he never actually sinned. That's the one big difference. Jesus was fully human, but he was without sin. And that's why he can be our Savior. But if you look closely in the Bible, we see that it also says that Jesus is the Son of God, who is himself God. So we'll see more about this in today's Bible passages. We're going to learn the clear answer to the big picture question by looking at our Bible. So if you could open your Bibles now to Matthew chapter 1 in the New Testament. In the Adventure Bible, it's page 1052. It is so exciting that we're finally now going into the New Testament. It's a new time, a new season for our church's lessons in the Gospel Project. And as you open your Bible to Matthew 1, I do want to say that as we begin the New Testament, it is very important that we connect it well from the Old Testament into the New Testament. They're not two completely disconnected different stories. It's all one big story of God. And so last week I made a video that I shared with some CM families. I don't know if YM or KYM families have seen it, but it's called the Old Testament Panorama. And it's a bunch of keywords that help us to remember this big picture of God's story in the Old Testament. And I do want to teach it to you right now, because I know some of you won't do it unless it's like right now. So I want to do it together and for me to also have a review. So are you ready? It's five different groups of words, one for each big storyline in the Old Testament. Okay, so if you can show us number one. I'm going to say the word and do a certain motion. So I know there's only a few people here at the church as we're recording this, but if you could follow after me and do it with me, it would be encouraging, okay? So let's try this. Ready? Creation, fall, flood, nations, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. That's section one, okay? Section two that goes into Exodus is Moses and his staff, the Passover, law, tabernacle. And what do you do in a tabernacle? Feasts and offerings. Counting and spying, wandering and dying. Second law, that's Deuteronomy. The third one, Joshua, divide and conquer, 12 tribes, judges, Deborah, Gideon, I got confused, Samson. Everyone did what was right in their own eyes, except Ruth and Samuel. This is section four in the United Kingdom. Saul, no heart for God. David, whole heart for God. Solomon, half heart. Divided kingdom, mostly bad kings. The prophets speak. Section five, Israel scattered. Judah, exiled. Judah, returned. Zerubbabel, temple. Esther, queen. Ezra, people. Nehemiah, wall. Waiting for 400 years for Jesus Christ. And that's the whole Old Testament. Let's give each other a round of applause. Good job, everyone who is here who did it with me. Good job. So for CM children and maybe YM youth, if you could record a video of yourself doing this whole Old Testament panorama with the keywords and send it to me by this Friday, that would be so very awesome. It will help you to review the whole Old Testament. And don't be shy about the motions. If you just do the words, it's kind of hard to remember the stories. So do your best. And as you see this whole series of keywords, we don't see Jesus in it. Not by name. Nobody mentions Jesus by name in the Old Testament because he wasn't born yet. But every one of these major stories of the Old Testament, they still point to Jesus. They point us to this awesome Savior that God promised to send one day. So the people in the Old Testament times, they were indeed waiting for this Messiah. So what kind of family do you think they thought he would be born into? Now we're going to look at Matthew 1. I think by now everyone hopefully has it opened. It says, the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah. And in verse 1, it says, this is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And for CM students, as you're listening to this, look for the words that fill in the blanks. And YM and KYM as well, if you can just find whoever you're familiar with, why don't you circle those names in your Bible, the stories that you know. So here we go. This is, I'm just going to read verse 1 to 6 up to King David and the United Kingdom of Israel. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Amminadab, Amminadab the father of Nahshon, Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. We're going to stop there. So fill in some of the blanks of the names. And I'm going to jump ahead. All of these names are important, but I'm going to jump ahead to verse 16. After the exile to Babylon, verse 16, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, and Mary was the mother of Jesus, who was called the Messiah. Thus there were 14 generations in all from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Messiah. 14, 14, 14. What does that even mean? Why did Matthew include that there were 14 generations from Abraham to David, then David to the exile, then the exile to the Messiah? What's the importance of that? Well, many Bible scholars believe that there may have been more people in between those times. Maybe it wasn't exactly 14, but the 14 are the important people that are worth mentioning in this genealogy, because the Old Testament people, Bible time people, whom this was first written for them, it was really important that there are equal time periods that point to this big epic event in history. So they believe that before the Messiah comes, before the beginning of the last days of the Messiah, there would be a fixed number of equal time periods that would pass before the beginning of the final age of the Messiah. So Matthew is trying to tell his Jewish readers, this is that time. The time has really come now. This is the final age of humankind with Jesus as the Messiah. It is Jesus that we've been waiting for. So if you were a Jewish person back in the first century and you're reading this, you would have been like, whoa, and it would have been really like epic. It would blow your mind. Another thing about this family tree, I want you to notice this. Do you notice that there are some women in the family tree? What we read earlier, we saw Tamar and Rahab and Ruth and Uriah's wife, four of them, including Mary, it's five. Back in the Old Testament times, women were actually not mentioned as part of anyone's genealogy. They were not part of this story. But why are they mentioned in Jesus' family tree? This is very not usual for a Bible time genealogy. And actually, if you know the stories of the four women, maybe later ask your parents so they can explain it to you. But Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and Uriah's wife, her name was Bathsheba, they all had some kind of very complicated life situation that made them not quite the perfect woman or the perfect kind of wife that regular people would be looking for. Ask your parents about their stories. But I think it shows that God definitely wants to include all kinds of people in his family, that God can use the humble, that God can use the imperfect, or hurt or broken, God can use them to fulfill his good plans. And also, I think it also shows that God cares about women and girls in a time when they were not cared for or treated as human. Nowadays, we take it for granted, but at that time, it was a very big deal that these women were included. Also, in my studies of the genealogy, guess what I found out? I found out that Pharisees of that time, you know, the Bible experts, the Old Testament experts, they were very sure that if there is a Messiah that is coming, the Savior of the world, he's definitely going to be born in the line of King David. That's what the Pharisees all believed at the time. He'll be born of a king He'll have royal ancestry. He'll be a kingly line. And so Matthew, the writer of the Gospel of Matthew, he especially wanted the Pharisees and Jews to know that Jesus, who came from this line of David, really was the Messiah. So all these things are happening in this list of people's names that you might not know if you just look at your Bible. Now, we're going to watch today's Bible video, and as we watch the Bible video, I want you to see who is the rest of Jesus' family, and what does the family tree look like? Do you recognize any of them, and what kind of people were they? Okay, so let's watch the Bible video.
Before he came to earth as a human being, God the Son was with the Father. No one created him. He has always existed. God created the first people.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Adam and Eve. But they did not obey him. All along, God planned to send his Son to earth to save people from sin. At just the right time, Jesus came to earth as a baby. He was born to Mary, the wife of Joseph. Jesus is different than any other baby who was ever born because he is fully God and fully human. Like all people on earth, Jesus' family had a history, a family tree. Jesus had parents, grandparents, great-grandparents, and great-great-grandparents, back and back for many generations. Jesus was born into the family of Abraham and the family of King David. Abraham had a son named Isaac. When Isaac had a family, one of his sons was named Jacob. Jacob was part of Jesus' family. Years later, a man named Solomon was born into Jesus' family tree. He married Rahab, who hid the Israelite spies when they came to Jericho. Rahab had a baby named Boaz. Boaz was a farmer, and he married Ruth. Boaz and Ruth had a son named Obed. Obed's son was Jesse. Jesse had many sons. His youngest was David. David was just a boy when he was chosen to be Israel's king. King David liked to write. He wrote songs called Psalms, and some of them were about the time when Jesus would come to earth. Other people in Jesus' family were kings too. David's son Solomon was a king. King Jehoshaphat was part of Jesus' family, and so was Uzziah, Ahaz, Hezekiah, and Josiah. God's people returned home from exile in Babylon. Then, Shealtiel was born. His son was Zerubbabel. Later, Matthan came along. Matthan's son was named Jacob, and Jacob's son was named Joseph. Joseph is the man who married Jesus' mother, Mary. Joseph raised Jesus as his own son. Jesus was truly God's son, the Messiah. Jesus came to earth as a human. Jesus had earthly parents, Mary and Joseph, but his true father is God. Through Jesus, God kept his promises to Abraham and David. Jesus saves people from their sins and adopts them into God's family.
When we see these videos, I love the sound effects. Every time there was a new person popping up, oh! Next time you pop into your parents' room, say that, oh! Did you recognize any of the other people that were mentioned in this genealogy? Hopefully for many of you who've been hearing these stories all throughout the Old Testament, you would have recognized a lot of those names. You may have seen that in the family line after King David came King Solomon and the divided kingdom, and then the exile to Babylon. And then after the exile, Zerubbabel, who rebuilt the temple, he was actually Jesus's ancestor. And then they go all the way down to Joseph, the husband of Mary, who was the mother of Jesus. And just in case some of you may not realize this, I have to say this, but Jesus was the physical son of Mary, but she did not become pregnant by her husband, Joseph. Remember that it was by the Holy Spirit. So it really was a true miracle that happened just one time, that one time in human history. So Jesus was not a son that came from Mary and Joseph's marriage relationship. So Joseph was not Jesus' biological father. But Joseph adopted Jesus as his son during his time on earth. I think that's a beautiful picture that is worth mentioning. Adopting someone into your family is a wonderful thing. So Jesus was adopted into Joseph's family, even though he wasn't Joseph's biological son. So Matthew gave us this family tree from Jesus' earthly adopted father and his ancestors, Joseph's side of the family, the legal line of descent. But we see through that one important fact, that the line of King David has been passed on to Jesus. And so Jesus fulfills all the promises in the Old Testament about the coming Messiah that they were all hoping for. We're going to look at one more genealogy. In Luke chapter 3, the Gospel of Luke, he writes down one more genealogy, family tree list, and it's on page 1127 in the Children's Bible. I'm going to wait for you to open it because these genealogies are fascinating to me. I want you guys to look at it with me. It's different a little bit from Matthew's genealogy because they're tracing two different lines that meet. Right before telling us the family tree, Luke tells us about an important time when Jesus was getting baptized. And what happened then was that the heavens opened up and God actually announced, God himself spoke from heaven about who Jesus was. So let's read that first. Verse 21, Luke chapter 3, verse 21 and 22. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." God actually announced from heaven and told everyone there that Jesus is the Son of God, that is loved by God, and who pleases God. What a wonderful announcement. And everyone who was there heard this voice of God together. Amazing. And then Luke wants to write to us about who is in his family. So let's just look at Luke chapter 3, verse 23 to 38. I'm not going to read it out loud because it will take a long time, but I want you to just kind of look at it quickly. Verse 27, you see Zerubbabel again. Then you keep going. And then you see in verse 31, King David. And then verse 33, there's Abraham. But then it keeps going further up from Abraham, all the way up to Noah in verse 35. And then verse 38, the son of Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. So this genealogy goes a little further up than Matthew's, and it traces it even more further up, all the way to Adam. And the first part that's a little different from Matthew's genealogy, it's because experts say that this list was a people group that was on Mary's side of the family. The other one was more Joseph's side, and then they actually meet in the middle and they share ancestry up further up. So if you look through the list, you're going to see some ancestors that overlap with Matthew's list all the way up to Adam, and then Luke's list that keeps going. It shows us the natural line of descent through Mary that goes all the way to Adam, that even goes up to God. So in every way, Jesus was the fulfillment of the hope that people of Israel had. They had long awaited this Messiah. Jesus is that Messiah, the Savior of the world. So at this point, you can write, the main point of today's message is that Jesus' family line proves that he is the Messiah, the Savior of the world. One point to make here is that many of the people mentioned in these two genealogies were very imperfect. Their lives were very messy, sometimes even very sinful. And we might ask this question, how can our perfect Savior come from such an imperfect family? Don't you think a perfect Savior should come from a more perfect family? That's exactly what the Pharisees thought. They were like, there's no way this guy, no, he's not the one we've waited for. But the problem is, there's just no such thing as a perfect family in this world. So if God waited to enter into our world only into a family line that was completely perfect, there actually would never have been a time where there would have been a family tree full of all perfect people that was worthy of God's Son being born into it. But that's exactly why Jesus came into the world. It's because we are all sinful and because we are all in need of a Savior. So when God sent Jesus into the world, it was into a very imperfect family tree. And the good news here is that God can use imperfect people like me and like you to accomplish his great big plan of salvation. And all of God's promises are for imperfect people. So the big picture question that we've been asking today, so is Jesus God or is Jesus a human? We find its answer one more time by looking at one more verse here. John 1, 1 and 2. I'll just read it to you. This is the key verse for this unit. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Who is this Word? It's actually one of the names of God. And you can replace the name, the Word, with Jesus. And you can read it again. Can you do that with me? Every time you see the Word, I want you to replace it with Jesus and read it one more time and see what it says. In the beginning, can you show us the Bible verse? Ready? In the beginning was Jesus. And Jesus was with God. And Jesus was God. Jesus was with God in the beginning. Jesus was there at the very beginning of creation. He existed forever, even before the world was created. And then he was born into a human body at the right time. So the big picture answer is that as the Son of God, Jesus is both fully God and fully human. And through the rest of August, we're going to see how this is possible. Now, I'm going to address your parents in Korean for just a few more minutes. So children and youth, don't go far. Work on your worksheet or spend some time meditating on the questions given to you. 부모님 여러분, 오늘 신약 성경의 첫 단추를 끼우는 아주 중요한 날입니다. 아주 첫 단추를 잘 끼워야 된다는 그런 말이 있죠. 제가 보는 신약의 첫 단추는 구약 시대와 신약 성경을 연결하는 것이 그 첫 단추라고 보는데요. 그래서 이번에 가스포 프로젝트를 통해서 아이들은 그나마 이제 구약의 많은 스토리들을 배워왔지만 예수님의 힌트를 보아왔지만 그것이 하나로 구슬을 꿰어서 스토리로 읽지 않으면 또다시 따로따로 떨어진 이야기처럼 남을 것 같아요. 그래서 구약 인물들이 이렇게 각자 따로따로 도는 그런 이야기가 아니라 다 하나로 연결되는 하나님의 구원의 스토리라는 것을 가르치고 싶습니다. 그래서 구약시대 파노라마를 그렇게 키워드를 통해서 암송하자고 했는데 그것이 정리하는 데 큰 도움이 될 거예요. 그래서 부모님들 여러분께서도 자녀와 함께 이 비디오 제가 또 한번 보내드릴게요. 외워보시고 그리고 금요일까지 한번 도전해보시면 좋을 것 같습니다. 구약의 마지막 말라기 선지자의 말씀 이후에 400년이나 흘렀습니다. 침묵의 세월이 아주 길었습니다. 그동안 메시아를 기다리면서 메시아에 대해 그림을 그려왔던 그런 바리새인들 또 그때 당시에 그 율법 전문가들의 기대가 있었습니다. 오늘 말씀을 통해서는 마태와 누가가 그 기다렸던 메시아가 바로 이 예수다 이것을 보여주신 거고 또 마태가 기록한 계보는 예수님의 육신의 아버지였던 요셉의 조상들을 기록한 것이었다고 하고요. 또 누가가 기록한 계보는 예수님의 육신의 어머님 이었던 마리아의 조상들을 거슬러 올라가며 아담까지 연결되어서 하나님께서 처음에 인간을 창조하셨을 그때까지 이어지는 것을 보게 됩니다. 아이들에게도 말했지만 계보에 언급되는 많은 사람들 중에 참으로 부족한 사람들이 많았습니다. 죄를 범한 사람도 많았고 또 특히나 언급된 여성 5명은 특히나 더 일반적인 눈으로 봤을 때는 좋지 않은 상황 가운데 아주 복잡한 인연을 통해서 자녀를 갖게 되었던 사람들이었습니다. 여러분께서 우리 아이들에게 이 이야기들을 여러분의 말로 적절하게 설명해 주시면 좋을 것 같아요. 근데 시아버지 유다를 통해서 임신하게 된 다말, 또 여리고 성의 기생이었던 라합, 이방인이었고 게다가 성적으로도 복잡한 과거가 있었고 또 모압 여성 룻은 일찍이 과부가 된 상태로 이스라엘로 이민을 왔고 보아스를 만나서 재혼한 것이고 또 이미 우리아의 아내였던 바세바는 모두 아시다시피 우리 다윗 왕의 인생의 가장 큰 오점으로 남겨지는 다른 사람의 아내를 탐내고 취한 그런 대상이었습니다. 마리아도 그 당시에는 요셉과 결혼하기 전에 이렇게 기적으로 하나님의 아들을 잉태하게 된 것이지만 인간적으로 봤을 때는 아주 복잡한 상황이었습니다. 그래서 이 질문이 중요합니다. How can our perfect savior come from such an imperfect family? 이것에 대한 여러분의 답이 가정생활을 하는데도 큰 영향이 있으리라고 저는 생각합니다. 복잡한 과거가 있는 사람들의 후손은 어떤 후손이 태어날까요? 그리고 온 세상을 다스리고 구원하시는 메시아가 이렇게 불완전한 가정에서 태어났다는 건 우리 가정에게는 복음일까요? 복음입니다. 왜냐하면 겉으로 보이는 모습과는 상관없이 우리 모두의 가정은 다 복잡한 과거사가 있고 숨기고 싶은 부분이 분명히 있습니다. 그리고 이 세상에는 완전한 가정이라는 것은 존재하지가 않는다는 것을 인정하는 것이 중요합니다. 근데 그게 바로 복음입니다. 왜냐하면 예수님께서 그 복잡하고 죄로 물든 가족의 후손으로 그들의 DNA를 받아서 인간의 육신을 입고 하나님께서 지으신 그 땅에 직접 태어나셨고 그것이 곧 하나님께서 지으신 세상을 향한 참 사랑이었다는 것. 그렇게 생각하면 우리 자녀들을 볼 때도 우리 조상들을 볼 때도 오점으로 남겨지는 그 많은 것들이 그 아이들 안에도 DNA로 남아있습니다. 그러나 그것이 전부가 아니라 하나님께서 그들을 통해 하시는 일을 우리는 보기를 원합니다. 그래서 예수님도 태초에 창조 전부터 하나님과 함께 계셨던 참된 하나님의 본체였다는 것을 기억하기를 원합니다. 단지 그 DNA가 그를 지정하지 않았다는 것이죠. 요한복음 1장 1절에서 3절 한국말로 한 번만 읽겠습니다. 태초에 말씀이 계시니라. 말씀은 예수님이죠. 이 말씀이 하나님과 함께 계셨으니 이 말씀 예수님은 곧 하나님이시니라. 그가 태초에 하나님과 함께 계셨고 만물이 그로 말미암아 지은 바 되었으니 지은 것이 하나도 그가 없이는 된 것이 없느니라. 정말 놀라운 진리입니다. 우리가 인간의 뇌로는 완전히 이해하기는 어려운 영적인 진리죠. 하나님의 정해진 때에 창조주였던 메시아 구세주 예수님이 세상에 인간으로 사람으로 태어났다는 것이에요. 그래서 이 신학적인 진리를 아이들한테도 일찍이 가르치면 좋겠습니다. Is Jesus God or human? 예수님은 완전한 사람이었고 또한 완전한 하나님이셨습니다. 우리에겐 그게 어떤 의미로 다가올까요? 하나님께서는 부족한 가족의 계보를 통해서 이렇게 구원의 역사를 이어나가시는 하나님이십니다. 그래서 예수님도 그런 가정에 태어났는데 내 가정에 어떤 흑역사, 그런 것이 과연 하나님 앞에서 또 사람 앞에서 부끄러울 것이 과연 있을까요? 은혜의 하나님을 붙잡는 여러분이라면 그렇다면 여러분 가정생활을 할 때 자녀들이 자라나는 동안 우리 가정의 자랑스러운 일들 또 우리 가정의 수치스러운 일들 그 모든 스토리를 다 구슬처럼 꿰어나가면서 가족의 많은 이야기를 아이들에게 나눠주시길 바랍니다. 그리고 이렇게 집에 오래오래 있으면서 따로 뭐 하시겠습니까? 이런 이야기를 많이 풀어야죠. 그래서 기회가 될 때마다 그런 가족의 스토리를 나눌 때 우리처럼 불완전한 사람들을 하나님은 사용하시고 하나님의 사랑으로 위대하신 그런 역사를 이끌어 가신다는 것을 하이라이트 하기를 원합니다. 또 우리 친척 중에 또 나는 언제 예수님의 가족 안으로 이렇게 입양이 된 것인가 그 시점을 한번 생각해보고 자녀들하고 많이 나누면 좋을 것 같아요. 그래서 우리도 입양된 하나님의 자녀인데 우린 몇 대째 믿는 집안이고 모태신앙이고 이런 것도 중요한 개념이긴 하지만 좀 트리키한 것 같습니다. 그래서 우리 자녀는 몇 대째 믿는 자녀인지 이런 것을 얘기해보는 것도 좋고 그러나 이 모두가 다 입양돼서 연결된 자녀라는 것도 강조해 주시면 좋을 것 같아요. 또 우리 친척 중에 아직 예수님 안 믿는 분들 계시다면 위에서 기도하시면 좋겠습니다. 또 우리 가족, 직계가족뿐이 아니라 우리 믿음의 하늘가족 안에 속해 있는 것도 너무나 중요합니다. 그래서 아까 광고 잠깐 드렸듯이 이번 가을에는 저희가 CM 소그룹 또 YM 사랑방을 신청을 받기를 했습니다. 왜냐하면 우리 교회에 적을 두고 있는 모든 가정들을 대상으로 원래는 반편성을 하는데 이번 기간 9월부터 1월 우리 학교 안 가고 집에서 있는 이 기간 동안에는 좀 집중적으로 저희가 누가 참여할 것인지를 미리 알아야 헌신하신 교사들에게도 제대로 배정을 해서 또 아이들에게도 제대로 교재를 나눌 수 있는 그룹이 형성될 것 같아요. 지금까지는 많이 안 들어온 소그룹들은 1대1로 한 소그룹도 많고요. 그래서 그거는 아이의 영적인 그런 사회성 교재를 위해서는 조금 더 많이 들어오면 좋겠다는 생각이 들고요. 그래서 그렇게 신청해 주시길 바랍니다. 하늘 가족의 일원으로 계속 교재를 나누는 것이 굉장히 중요하기 때문에 그렇게 격려합니다. 끝으로 말씀을 맺으면서 우리가 이렇게 신학적으로 오늘 내용은 사실 굉장히 신학적인 내용이었는데요. 아무리 그런 띠아와지를 아이들에게 가르쳐도 사실은 아무리 하나님이 하나님이셨고 인간이 예수님이 인간이셨고 이런 이야기를 나누어도 예수님의 계보에 우리가 어떻게 속하는지 아이들이 삶으로 체험하지 않으면 와닿지가 않을 것입니다. 그래서 그 은혜가 뼛속까지 스며들기 위해서는 여러분께 마지막으로 말씀드립니다. 자녀가 이번 주에 불완전한 모습으로 행동을 할 때 그런 모습에도 불구하고 하나님이 너를 사랑하신다. 그리고 그런 모습에도 불구하고 하나님이 너를 자녀 삼으셨고 입양하셨고 너를 통해서 언젠가 하나님이 큰 일을 행하실 것이라는 그런 연결을 해주시면 그것이 참으로 아이의 영혼에는 축복이 될 거라고 믿습니다. Children, if you could come back. Youth, we're going to sing our final song of the day. Your grace is enough. We want to remember that Jesus was born into an imperfect human family because God's grace wants to show us that even we as imperfect sinners can be included in God's family. And so we want to remember that God remembers us, his children, and continues on this generation of God's love and his story. So let's sing together, Your Grace is Enough.
Great is your faithfulness.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart.
So remember.
So remember your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, O God.
Your grace.
For your grace is enough. Your Remember your promise, oh.
Together, saying to God, Your grace is enough. Grace is God's empowering ability that is available to us. Something that we cannot do for ourselves. That's what God's grace is. God's grace is available. Another way to say is that God's reign or God's presence is available to you and me. That's the good news. Today's story, a wonderful story, that it's, I think a key word there is connection. The Old Testament, the New Testament is connected. All the way from Adam to Jesus and Jesus to us. And through Jesus, we can be connected to one another. And what a great news is, that is, that we're not alone. I think what was emphasized is that even though we are so imperfect, life is so complicated, God's reign, God's presence is available right in the midst of the complicated life, uncertainty of our life, a pandemic. So let's take advantage of God's availability for us. That's the good news. Hopefully it's a closing thought that we can take away with us. 네. 학부모님 예수님의 이름으로 축복합니다. 네, 특별히 이제 가을 학기 때 아이들이 이제 학교에 돌아가지 않고 그럴 때 아마 마음이 많이 무거울 것 같습니다. 그런데 오늘의 메시지는 그 하나님의 임재, 하나님의 그 은혜가 그 가운데서도 있다는 것이죠. 그래서 그 은혜를 의지하면서 나갈 때 또 우리가 상상할 수 없는 것을 하나님의 은혜로서 이루어질 것을 기대하시기 바랍니다. 그러한 마음으로 마지막 기도를 하겠습니다. 다 같이 기도하겠습니다. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this story, the genealogy that connects all the way from Adam, who was created by you, our first ancestor, all the way to Jesus, the promise. You fulfill the promise, and that promise continues to come to us. So Lord, as we close, that grace, that your commitment to stay with us in the middle of our chaos, in the middle of imperfect, uncertain life, one thing is certain, that is you, your grace, your reign. And I pray that that would be a comfort to all the families that's going through a very tough time. Your grace in the middle of this, may we really say every day, is enough. So to have that faith, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the never-ending love of God the Father and the presence, the fellowship, the enablement of the Holy Spirit be with each family who have come to worship now and forever. Amen.